What am I asking you to know about the skin? The layers? We talked about that, right? I define the true skin, the dermal layer, right? Then I explain to you the epidermis. Yeah? Oh, really? And the functions? And there's no functions on there?
No functions.
Where? What does it say? Is that, oh, the integumentary? Yeah, that's the skin. You know. Okay. All right, hang on a second. Why isn't this working? You okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
What did you do?
Yeah, he tricked me.
How do I get out of this?
What?
This. All clothes.
Press the back button.
How come this ain't working?
Control up.
Oh, here we go. All right, and then next week we'll pick times for the lab and the oral final, okay? And then finish up, and that's all she wrote. Okay, so here we go. I talked to you about the function of sebaceous glands and releasing sebum, oil. Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, we did pretty good then, right? Okay, so watch. The functions of the skin, number one, is to, one of them is to regulate body heat, right? In the dermal layer, you have these small arteries, arterioles, and when the body temperature gets high, these arterioles will dilate. And when they dilate, more warm arterial blood is going to be able to be dissipated through the skin. Also sweating, right? And that's really the best way to dissipate heat. The other big function is protection. The best barrier you have against infection is intact skin. And then third is to remove small amounts of waste. One of the waste products that can be gotten rid of by the skin is urea. And when urea gets on the surface of the skin, you have bacteria. You have 10 times more bacteria on your skin than you do cells in your body. So the bacteria will metabolize that urea, and that's why people stink when they sweat. You got that? And those are really the primary functions of the skin. Let's make sure I covered them all. Yeah, I did. Regulate the body heat, boom. And it's the best protection you have. The other thing too, it helps regulate fluid balance. So if you ever got a really bad sunburn, you get really thirsty, because one of the things that the skin does is it helps hold moisture in the body. And then I talked about how you get a tan, yes, why people with darker skin have darker hair, that melanin usually dictates the color of people's iris as well. Okay. All right. we'll leave that alone. How about that? That's a skin.
You're recording, right?
Yes, I am. We're 5 minutes and 12 seconds into this wonderful class. Okay, here we go. Nervous system. The nervous system, this is very important, the nervous system controls the minute to minute, second to second changes that occur in the human body in an attempt to maintain homeostasis. So the nervous system reacts quickly, but its effects can go away quickly. The nervous system is augmented and can be amplified by the endocrine system. So the example that I gave you is, watch, if you think the Hamburglar's in your house and you get scared, right? You're going to get the release of epinephrine. But as soon as you find out that there's nobody in your house, you can't just go back to sleep. So the nervous system will turn off at that time, but you have the effects of the endocrine system and epinephrine. All right, so this is very important. The nervous system is divided into two main parts. You have the central nervous system, and that's made of your brain and spinal cord. And then you have the peripheral nervous system. And the peripheral nervous system, peripheral, yeah, is made up of 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And I'll go into more detail about that in a little bit. Now, the primary processing centers is the central nervous system, primarily the brain. Just so you know, the brain has no pain receptors, sensory receptors. So if you cut open somebody's skull and start munching on their brain, they won't feel that. Who wants to volunteer to have their skull cut open so we can kind of push on their brain? Nobody?
I don't feel like reenacting Hannibal.
You could get extra credit. I'm thinking maybe 4 or 5 points. All right. I just wanted to put it out there. No takers. Okay, watch. This is even more important. No longer after taking this class can you say to someone, "You're getting on my nerves." That's not correct. What you have to say now is, "You're getting on my central nervous system." Because that... the nervous system is the primary process, central nerve, you know what I'm talking about. Okay, anyways, that didn't go over very well. All right, question for you. Does the spinal cord process any neural information, or is it merely a relay station between the cells of the body and the brain, which is the primary processing center? Does it? Does it?
Doesn't it? Wait, what was the first part of the question?
All right. General AMP, gateway to the Watch. Does the spinal cord do any processing of neural information? Or is simply a relay station from the peripheral nervous system to the brain? Does it?
I thought you said it processes you said something about it the other day, how there's like little nerves in the spinal cord and it like...
Oh, you remember that?
Yeah.
I am so proud of you.
Like, wasn't it like heat? Like if you touch something hot, you say, ow, and then...
But you feel that, you sense that in your brain.
Yeah, we're talking about the brain.
The spinal cord processes reflexes. So reflexes, as the name implies, occur reflexively. You don't have to think about it. Watch. Did you ever go to the doctor and they do the physical on you and they do the little knee tap thing? Mm-hmm. You could be, you know, in a coma and you're still going to get that patella tendon reflex because that processing occurs at the level of the spinal cord. So watch. You put your hand on a hot stove, there are nerve endings that will sense that pain. It will then travel through a sensory nerve to the spinal cord. And then the spinal cord is going to connect it to a motor nerve that's going to cause your hand to be pulled away. At the same instant, it is also going to send electrical impulses to your brain to say, ouch. Tell me you got that. That's reflexes. All right. So we're going to talk about now, I'm going to talk about the 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And I'll give you an introduction into the neuron in a minute. Now watch. You have 31 pairs of spinal nerves. And that makes up the peripheral nervous system. The peripheral nervous system, then, with these 31 pairs of spinal nerves, gets further subdivided into two main parts. Does anyone know what they are? For a swig off my Diet Mountain Dew, a light blue marking pencil that needs to be sharpened, and some scissors. What are the two divisions of the peripheral nervous system? Oh, you were so close. Oh, even closer. Come on. Elizabeth, what is it? And? Come on.
Autonomic.
Right. Autonomic. Somatic means body. That refers to skeletal muscle. Are you in control of your skeletal muscle? Most days, right? Can you decide to pick your nose? Right? You can get in there up to your wrist if you want to. So that is conscious control. The autonomic nervous system, on the other hand, occurs, as the name implies, automatically. And what are the two divisions, Haley, of the autonomic nervous system?
That's parasympathetic.
That's right. You have the parasympathetic and the sympathetic. And the parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system work like an old man drives a car. They never take their foot off the brake and they never take their foot off the accelerator. If they want to go faster, they simply punch the gas. But they always keep their foot on the brake. So what is that telling you? I'm going to say this really slow because it's really important. In the autonomic nervous system, you always have some parasympathetic stimulation and you always have some sympathetic stimulation. When you're scared, you simply have more sympathetic stimulation. When you are resting and digesting, you have more parasympathetic stimulation, but you always have a little bit of each. Do you ever notice that as people get older, their cars get bigger? I saw this little old lady at Pick and Save pulling out with a sled, man. This thing was a giant, like Lincoln. Right? What?
I just probably because she got smaller.
But when she pulled out, it looked like nobody was driving the car. Then I pulled up next to her, and she had those little cataract sunglasses on. Then she looked at me, and she goes like this. Are you ready? Okay, so let me break the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system down for you a little bit. Hi, Sadika. Did you bring me anything to eat or drink? Yeah, well, whatever. Okay, watch. This is the autonomic nervous system. Watch. You have the sympathetic, and the sympathetic nerves, the spinal nerves that come off to form the sympathetic nervous system, kind of come off the middle of the spinal cord. The parasympathetic exit the spinal cord from the top and bottom. And the word para means around. So the parasympathetic is around the sympathetic. Now, this is critical, absolutely critical. As you can see clearly from this lovely diagram, the sympathetic nerves, when they exit the spinal cord, then come together and form a network. So write this down. A ganglion is a group of nerves. I'll get into a little more detail later. This is what I want you to know. The sympathetic nervous system, after it exits the spinal cord, all of those nerves that make up the sympathetic nervous system get connected together. So what that means is this. If you see a spider, and you get scared, that's going to activate the sympathetic nervous system. That, all of those nerves, once they're stimulated, they come together and get connected in this sympathetic ganglion. So what that means is that when you get scared all over. Do you understand? You could never use this excuse. Tim, I can't come to class today. My liver's scared. So when you activate the sympathetic nervous system, you better write this down. Better not pout. When you activate the sympathetic nervous system, you get massive, wholesale changes in your body's physiology. And it has a single purpose. The single purpose of activating the sympathetic nervous system is, you better write this down. Sadika, you writing this down? Is to prepare your body to run or fight. That's its only purpose. I prefer to run because I could get hurt. Ain't that right? So watch. You better write this down too. The hormone of the sympathetic nervous system is epinephrine. And we know a little bit about epinephrine, don't we? Don't we? Oh, yeah. Okay, so watch. Watch. These are some of the changes that occur in people's physiology when the sympathetic nervous system is turned on. Number one, your pupils dilate. Why would you want your pupils to dilate when your sympathetic nervous system is activated? Where are you more likely to get scared? On a nice sunny day in a park with all your friends and family around, or in a dark alley where it's raining and you hear, "I'm going to kill you." Right? That was a good example, huh? So the reason your pupils dilate during the sympathetic stimulation is to allow more light in so that you can see better. You got me? So when you open up your pupils, more light can get in, you can see images better. Do you need saliva to run or fight for your life? Do you?
No.
You need saliva to digest food. So are you going to be running and then slobber is going to be coming out of your mouth? No, that's why. How many people in here have had speech? So you have your little persuasive speech. I'm in favor of the death penalty. And your mouth gets really dry. That's why in court, they have water there. Because you're nervous and people lie. I didn't know that. Body doing stuff that makes sense. Tell me you got that. What's going to happen to your heart rate and blood pressure? Please get this one right.
It goes up because of massive vasoconstriction.
Yeah. What's going on with you? Do you drink some A&P juice before you come to class?
No.
Your heart rate goes up and your systolic blood pressure goes up. And what Lara said was, she's absolutely right. All of your arteries throughout your body that were like this, now go like this. So you get massive arterial vasoconstriction everywhere. And according to all previous learning here, people, according to Ohm's flow law, if the arteries get smaller, what happens to resistance to arterial blood flow? So what happens to your systolic blood pressure? Why? See, you guys do that all the time. What's the goal of the cardiovascular system? You got to maintain blood flow, maintain Q. Say yes, watch. This is why little grandma, she's laying in bed. Before she goes to bed, God bless Tammy. Then she goes to bed. Then she thinks that the Hamburglar's in the house. So she gets scared. And her heart rate and blood pressure go up. You got me? And the little arteries in her vein, in her head, her brain, can't handle that pressure. So little grandma strokes out. So you'll find people two places when they either have a stroke or a heart attack. On the toilet, yeah? Or after some type of event that stimulates the sympathetic nervous system. So one of the problems that people have as they age is constipation. So they're grunting and groaning trying to get that turd out, and it's hard because they don't drink water. So when you do that, your blood pressure goes through the roof and they can stroke out from that. That's why all elderly people and the last medication on a medication sheet in the hospital, that's Spanish for hospital, is a stool softener. That's why they do that. Because watch, is being sick stressful? Dis-ease. So if you're not at ease, you're stressed. So what nervous system is stimulated? Sympathetic. And that decreases, watch it, it decreases GI activity. That's why they get constipated. I'm giving myself a check plus because that was good information. I should start doing more of that for me. Need that. What happens to your blood sugar? Sciatica, when you're scared. Why? Well, those are your choices. Up or down? Goes up. What's the only fuel your brain can use? So do you want your blood sugar low where you're dizzy, lightheaded, and confused when you're running or fighting for your life? Or do you want to make sure that you can see and think clearly when you're going to run or fight for your life? There you go. Watch it. Watch it. I know I explained this, but I'm going to explain it to you again because it's important. Who goes to the hospital? Sick people. Sick people go to the hospital. Are you writing that down? Lara's actually writing that down. Look what I learned in class. Sick people go to the hospital. So when you're sick, you have dis-ease. What happens to your blood sugar when you are stressed, sick? Goes up. So people who are diabetic, they have to take more insulin when they're sick. That's great information. Fine, be that way. Watch. The sympathetic nervous system directly innervates the adrenal medulla. Epinephrine is released from the adrenal medulla. So the hormone of the sympathetic nervous system is our buddy, our pal, epinephrine. Say yeah. Okay, watch. What happens to your blood clotting? What happens to the ability of blood to clot when you're scared? Do you want that blood to clot quicker or slower when you're scared? Think again. Use your George Costanza approach. Whatever you think you should say, say the opposite.
Want it to clot faster?
When are you more likely to bleed? When you're sleeping in bed or running or fighting for your life? I would think so too. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's right, and skin your knee,
uh-huh.
And then your mom would put some Mercuricome on it.
But why do you want it to clot faster? So that you don't bleed out to death, right?
There you go. I would have people come in that had like stab wounds, right? They got into a fight, and there was no blood coming out of the wound, even though it was a nice gaping wound. Because what does epinephrine do to blood vessels? And because the clotting mechanism that operates quicker, people will stop bleeding quicker when they're scared.
So once the epinephrine is out of their system, will they start to bleed then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. So that's why, like in operating rooms, it's cold in an operating room. Because if it's warm, all of that blood that used to go to their body is in the skin, and when you cut through the skin, they will bleed like a stuck pig. That's why it's cold in there. See how good that was? Like that. Huh. Okay. He actually whistles really good. Who is that?
Efficient car delivery person.
Okay, rock on. Okay, tell me you followed that.
Yeah.
All right, watch. It also inhibits bladder contraction. So when you are scared or nervous, you can't pee. So if you have to pee, just relax. Think good thoughts, positive thoughts. You're with me. Anytime you increase your blood pressure, you increase it everywhere, including your... And that momentary increase in blood pressure before you start running or fighting, that will increase urine production and make you have to go pee. Now watch, watch. Do marathon runners, even though their blood pressure's up, do they have to pee it all the time? Do you see them stopping behind a tree and tinkling? No. That's because the vast majority of their blood is going to their muscles and is being diverted away from their kidney, and if blood doesn't go to the kidney, you don't make urine.
But it's not usually until you stop, isn't that correct?
Then when you stop, then do you have to pee?
Yeah.
Yes.
I used to do cross country and literally like ran so hard in a race where I like literally peed my pants after I passed out.
Yeah. You did? Did you win?
Well, Well, I mean, I place really well, yeah, but it takes so much out of your body that's like,
Oh, yeah. One of the things that happens too is that if you run really hard, your blood sugar will drop very, very low.
Oh,
And
so
the
I really
only,
like pass out.
yeah.
Yeah.
And the only fuel that the brain can use and the peripheral nervous system can use is glucose. So if your blood sugar drops, the ability of this to work properly doesn't. That's why people get kind of goofy, like after long races, like marathons and stuff. Like, it's called bonking. You ever hear of it? Yeah. Tell me you got that. That's the sympathetic nervous system. Surrounding the sympathetic nervous system is the parasympathetic nervous system. The parasympathetic nervous system is referred to as rest and digest. So you're going to increase the production of saliva. Pupils are going to be constricted. You don't want your pupils wide open when you're trying to sleep, right? You want them small so no light gets in so you can sleep. And before you go to bed, God bless Timmy. Bronchioles constrict, GI activity is stimulated, and you start releasing bile. And the reason you know what bile's for, don't you? Yeah, that's right. And then your bladder contracts. Now watch. This is important from a clinical standpoint. Yes? You can give a drug. Let's say, for example, you want somebody's pupils to dilate. You can give a drug that mimics the sympathetic nervous system, or you can give a drug that blocks the parasympathetic nervous system. So if you, the old man driving the car, if you cut his brakes, the only thing he's got is the accelerator. So by giving a drug that blocks the parasympathetic nervous system, you will get this unopposed sympathetic drive. And you, the result will be the same. A drug that does that is called atropine. Have you ever heard of atropine? Atropine is used to cause pupils to dilate. So if you go get a dilated eye exam, they will drop in atropine, so that will block the parasympathetic and cause your pupils to dilate. Old people who are drooling all the time, they will give them atropine drops. Ain't that right? Because that blocks the parasympathetic, and what happens to saliva production when you're scared, Sadika? It goes down. Say yes. What does the sympathetic nervous system do to your bronchioles? It dilates them because you need to get more air in and out of your lungs when you're running or fighting for your life, right? So it dilates your bronchioles. So there's a, you ever heard of this? This inhaler, Atrovent, you ever hear of it? Atrovent blocks the parasympathetic, so you get unopposed sympathetic stimulation cause the bronchioles to dilate. What's that stuff they give for diarrhea? Lomotil? Lomotil? You've heard of this? You never heard of it? Watch. If somebody's having diarrhea, that means their intestines are contracting too much. What does the sympathetic nervous system do to GI activity? Well, just read it. It stops it. So there's a drug called Lomotil that blocks the parasympathetic nervous system. So if you block it, what's going to happen to GI activity? It's going to slow down. So now I'm trying to teach you something. What are the side effects of Lomotil? Decreased production of saliva. What can happen to somebody's blood sugar if they're on Lomotil? got the PDR. You're getting it right from the horse's mouth right here, people. You can't get anything better than the PDR, darn it. Where is it? Anticholinergic. Anti-parasympathetic. Wait. Don't they have any numbness, anaphylactic, drowsiness, urticaria, anxiety? Oh, they don't even show it. That ain't bad. But tell me you got that. You're following this. That's how it works. So if somebody has diarrhea and you don't have any low modal, scare them. That's how that works. Okay. This is not going to make a lot of sense right now, but I'm going to tell you anyway since we're on it. I'm going to write this out. Oh, God, no. Oh. You ever try to fix something and you really don't know what you're doing? So you just start tightening some screws and you think that's going to make a difference? Yeah, that's not really good. All right, hang on. Okay, watch. Now get this. Don't touch other nerves. They don't come in direct contact with them. And they don't touch cells of the body. They form an area. This area where a nerve and a cell communicate. That's called, who said that? That's called a synapse. Are you with me? Now watch. We learned this day number one. I'll never forget it. It was a Monday. I explained to you that the two systems that require electricity are what? That's right. So electrolytes produce the electrical impulses that travel down this nerve. And when this nerve is stimulated by electricity, it causes the release of a chemical called a neurotransmitter. You got me? If you've had psychology, you probably talked about this, yes? They beat it down into you?
Yeah.
Neurotransmitters. These are chemicals. Are you with me? So watch. When an electrical impulse travels over the nerve, it is going to cause the release of this neurotransmitter. And in order for this neurotransmitter to affect this cell, it has to, you're not going to believe this. Are you going to believe it? It has to bind with a specific neurotransmitter receptor. Oh, yeah. See? Oh, yeah. You got that? So if you don't want this nerve to stimulate this cell, you give them a drug that blocks the neurotransmitter receptor. I mean, cut it out. Do you see this? So, watch. You're also not going to believe this either. Neurotransmitters are made of protein. And what's important about proteins? What is really going on with you today?
Oh, is that wrong?
No, that's absolutely right.
Oh.
Was there like some kind of brain transfer or something going on? I mean, you're killing it today, right? I think you're probably just excited about that 4-day break maybe, huh?
Yeah,
and that gets the neurons firing. I get it. Okay, neurotransmitter protein. You've probably heard of these. Have you ever heard of acetylcholine? You've heard of that? I'm going to just tell you this. Acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter for skeletal muscle. If you don't have any acetylcholine, you ain't going to be able to contract your skeletal muscle. Watch it. How many people have ever heard of Curare? You ever watch like the Animal Channel or the Discovery Channel where they have the little naked pygmies with spears and blow darts? You never see that? They dip that dart in curare. So when they see like a little pig running and they go and it hits them, you're not going to believe this. They run for a little bit and then they fall down. Because what's the neurotransmitter that causes skeletal muscle to contract? Guess what curare does to acetylcholine receptors on skeletal muscle? Have you ever heard of a drug called Pavulon? Never? Pavulon works like curare. Just so you know, the diaphragm is a skeletal muscle. So if you give somebody Pavulon and they're not on a ventilator, they're going to be taking a 6-foot dirt nap. Ain't that right? You should see the effects of Pavulon. It is amazing. There was this guy, just real quick. He comes out of surgery. He was a drunk and a drug addict. Do you know what tolerance is? Mm-hmm. Tolerance is you have to take more and more of a drug to get the same desired effect, right? So this guy comes out. When your liver gets destroyed from boozing and drugging, the portal vein takes all the blood from the GI tract and brings it back to the liver to be filtered. We learned this, right? You watch the videos, yes? If your liver is damaged, the same amount of blood is trying to come back to your liver. Liver's over here, by the way. But it can't because the liver's damaged. And we learned that there's no pressure in the veins, right? They're thin-walled. So that blood from the GI tract is going to back up into the GI tract and cause the veins of the GI tract to balloon out. That's why people with liver failure, they get GI bleed. Esophageal varices start bleeding, so they vomit and crap blood. That's how they die. His esophageal varices were so bad that they had to remove part of his lung and put his stomach up here. Tell me you're with me. This guy came out of surgery, and I'm taking care of him, and that anesthesia did nothing for this guy, so he is doing all of this, and I call the surgeon. I'm like, look, I got to paralyze this dude, otherwise you're going to be coming back and doing surgery on him again. So he goes, go ahead, give him some Pavilion. But what you're supposed to do is give them Versed first so they kind of go to sleep a little bit. Then you give them Pavilion. This guy was a jerk, right? So I gave him the Pavilion first. So he's like this, right? And all of a sudden he goes, and he don't know what's going on. And all of a sudden you can see like his pupils dilate, right? And his heart rate goes up real high. And then I push the Versed in. I said, be nice when you wake up. Pavilion. Watch it. Acetylcholine. How about dopamine? You've heard of that? Dopamine helps regulate, well, it's got tons of things. One of the things it does, and we'll talk about this, is it helps refine movement. Without dopamine, we all kind of shake and we walk with a shuffle. So people with Parkinson's disease lack dopamine. Serotonin. You ever heard of that? Serotonin has many effects. One of its biggest effects is its effect on mood. So when I start talking to you about neurons and stuff like that, I'll explain more about that. So these neurotransmitters are released from the ends of nerves, and I'll be more specific later. And in order to exert their effect on cells or other nerves, you have to have a specific receptor to bind there. You got me? All right. I'm going to leave that alone for a minute. Okay. What I want to do now is I want to talk to you about some of the anatomy and then give you some clinical examples of why understanding this stuff is important. So let's look at this. We learned that organs of the body have a saran wrap that covers the organ directly. Then there's a little space, and then there's a thick, tough lining that covers the inside of the body cavity, right? The lungs are the easiest example. You have the parietal pleura that lines the inside of the thoracic cavity, and then you have the visceral pleura that cover the lungs directly, right? The brain is no different, but the unique thing about the brain is this, and I would write this down. The brain has a central nervous system, has no lymphatic system. So it essentially has no immune system. So the environment of the central nervous system has to be tightly controlled. There is stuff in the blood that if it got into the brain would be bad for you. So you have to tightly control this environment of the central nervous system. So the brain not only has two protective layers, it has three protective layers. So the brain and spinal cord, these protective layers are called the meninges. So if you get inflammation or infection of the meninges, you have meningitis. Are you following me? So watch. And I'm going to explain this really slow because it really is important. Here's the brain. You have this thin, delicate layer that covers the brain and spinal cord directly. That thin, delicate layer that covers the brain and spinal cord directly is called the pia mater, or delicate mother. Now watch. Suspended above the pia mater, suspended above the pia mater by these little protein girders, is the arachnoid mater. And the reason it's called arachnoid is these little protein filaments resemble a spider's web. Arachnoid spider. There you go. Are you following? And then lining the inside of the skull and the spinal column is the outer thickest layer called the dura mater. Durable, Duracell, Durango. this is really important. Below the arachnoid mater, so you got the arachnoid mater right here. Below it, this is called the subarachnoid space. And the subarachnoid space is filled with a clear fluid called cerebral spinal fluid. And I'm going to explain more about that in a minute. Cerebral spinal fluid circulates around the entire brain and spinal cord. And the function of cerebral spinal fluid, number one, is to provide buoyancy for the brain and spinal cord. That's a bad color. You know this. You know this. If you've ever been in a pool, right? Like, say you got like a little kid in a pool, right? And you're putting them up and down in the water, right? They're in the water, so you put them up and down. When you're lifting them in the water, they feel very, very light, right? But when you try to lift them out of the water, like, whoa. Because water buoys you up. It pushes up. That's why a big freaking tanker out in the lake, even though it weighs like 8 gazillion pounds, it can still float on the water because the water will push it up. That's buoyancy. Your brain weighs about 3 pounds. If it wasn't for the fact that it floated in cerebral spinal fluid, the weight of the brain itself would crush the blood vessels and you would be dead. So cerebral spinal fluid provides that buoyancy where the brain itself weighs probably about like a half a pound, less than that, like maybe 10 ounces when it's floating in cerebral spinal fluid. You got that. Now, so what does cerebral spinal fluid do? It provides buoyancy for the brain and spinal cord. Number two, it removes metabolic waste from the central nervous system, brain and spinal cord. Yeah, and it also transports nutrients. To the brain and spinal cord. So, I want to show you this. I'm going to take this really slow because this is important. Did I show you this? This is Deborah Messing, another star here in General A&P, Gateway Technical College. So let's look at the list of stars we've had. We've had Tiger Woods with pneumonia, Glenn Close with her respiratory system exposed, and Kenny as a bladder. Now we got Deborah Messing. Okay, watch. I'm going to take this really slow. Here's your brain. The delicate layer that covers your brain is called what? Pia mater. Then suspended above the pia by these little protein filaments, not shown in this diagram, is what? The arachnoid mater. And then lining the skull and the spine vertebral column is the thick outer layer called the dura mater. Now, this is important. I'm going to say this really slowly. In the brain, only in the brain, only in the brain, the dura mater folds on itself. And it forms a pocket. This pocket that it forms is called the dural sinus. So let me show you. So here you have the dura that lines the inside of the skull. And then, as you can see, the dura folds on itself and comes in contact with the arachnoid. So wherever you see this blue, this is the dural sinus. And the dural sinus, better write this down, better not pout. The dural sinus is filled with venous blood. And where do all veins of the body, all venous blood get dumped into? That's right. You should have said that with a little more enthusiasm, because you knew that. So you learned something in this class, didn't you? Yeah, whatever. Okay, you got me? All right. The dural sinus is only found in the brain, not in the spinal cord. Dural sinus only found in the brain, not in the spinal cord. So watch. In your brain, you have chambers. Just like in your heart, you have chambers. In your brain, you have these four chambers called ventricles. So you have ventricles in your brain. These are hollow, well, they're not hollow, but they're fluid-filled chambers. And what these ventricles are filled with is cerebral spinal fluid. How many people are following me here? So let's now look at some of the anatomical features of the ventricles. First of all, you have two ventricles, one ventricle, or two lateral ventricles, one for each hemisphere. So the lateral ventricles are right here. Then you have a little hole between the lateral ventricles and the third ventricle. That little hole between the lateral ventricle and the third ventricle is called the interventricular foramen. Foramen is a hole that's supposed to be there. Are you with me? So you have lateral, then you have the third ventricle, third. Then you have this little canal here. That little canal that connects the third and fourth ventricle, fourth. This little canal that connects the third and fourth ventricle is called the cerebral aqueduct. An aqueduct is a channel, a fluid-filled channel. So the cerebral aqueduct connects the third ventricle to the fourth ventricle. What are the ventricles filled with? Cerebral spinal fluid. So here we go. Here we go. What's the dural sinus filled with? Oh. Venous blood, right? Where do all veins dump their venous blood? There we go. Alright, so watch. Embedded in all four ventricles is a group of cells and a network of capillaries. Called the choroid plexus. The choroid plexus is a group of specialized cells and a network of capillaries. And the function of the choroid plexus is to produce cerebral spinal fluid. So, what color is the plasma of the blood? Plasma of the blood. Clear. Cerebral spinal fluid is basically filtered blood plasma. So, should there be any white blood cells in cerebral spinal fluid? Should there be any red blood cells? Should there be large proteins like albumin in there? No. So, cerebral spinal fluid, for the most part, contains electrolytes, glucose, some other stuff, clearly. But it is basically has the same constituents as blood plasma. And blood plasma is clear. Are you with me? What produces cerebral spinal fluid? The choroid plexus. And you have a choroid plexi in every ventricle. The two biggest choroid plexi are in the lateral ventricles. Are you following me so far, guys? All right, so watch. When cerebral spinal fluid is produced, when it's produced, it will circulate through the two lateral ventricles. It will come through the interventricular foramen to the third ventricle. It will then go through the cerebral aqueduct and then into the fourth ventricle. Then you have this little thing that looks like a big leaf. This part of your brain is called the cerebellum, or little brain. And there is a little opening called the fourth ventricular aperture. Aperture is a hole. And it will allow that cerebral spinal fluid to circulate around the cerebellum. Are you with me? And then it will circulate around your spinal cord. This is very important. Very important. Write this down. Tattoo it. I'm not even playing. If you get a tattoo, I'll give you lots of extra credit. Tons of it. Maybe enough to buy a new car. Watch. Cerebral spinal fluid produced in the choroid plexus of the brain. Come on, Timmy. Circulates around the entire length of the spinal cord and then back up. Are you following? That cerebral spinal fluid will then circulate around the entire length of the spinal cord and then up and around the brain in the subarachnoid space. Who's with me? Sadek, are you with me or no? No, I don't think you are. Very upsetting. So watch. cerebral spinal fluid that circulates around the brain and spinal cord. Come on. And it will travel over the brain. This is important. As you can see, do you see these little indentations right here? You see that? These are called arachnoid villi. And these arachnoid villi are essentially drains that connect, these drains connect the subarachnoid space where the cerebral spinal fluid circulates to the dural sinus. What's in the dural sinus? Venous blood. So as cerebral spinal fluid circulates around the brain and spinal cord, it will then get drained into the dural sinus by these arachnoid villi. And because the dural sinus has venous blood, that will then drain back into the right atrium. So that's how cerebral spinal fluid is formed and then how it circulates. Now, on average, the average adult makes anywhere from about 400 to 600 milliliters of cerebral spinal fluid per day. But at any given time, there's only about 150 milliliters circulating around the brain and spinal cord. So if you make 600, but only 150 is circulating at any given time, that means that some of that excess cerebral spinal fluid has to be removed. And how it's removed is through these little arachnoid villi and then dumped into the dural sinus. How many people got that? You following this? So sometimes when babies are developing in the womb, there is malformation of these arachnoid villi, these little drains. And if you recall, a baby's skull is not fixed. There is this little tough connective tissue, right, that allows the skull to actually expand as the baby's brain grows, called fontanelles. Remember, you might, don't touch the soft spot. Remember that? So, if these arachnoid villi are not made correctly, right, or they're malformed, the baby's brain still produces cerebral spinal fluid, but it can't be adequately drained. So the pressure that that cerebral spinal fluid puts on the skull will cause the skull to expand, and it will also compress the brain. So that's a condition called hydrocephalus. Have you heard of this? Most of the time these kids are mentally retarded because of the compression of the brain as well and the cutting off of blood supply to the brain as the brain's trying to develop. So what they do for these people, if they survive, is they put in a tube into the ventricles, and then that tube runs under the skin of the skull and then down into the abdominal cavity, and that's called a ventricular shunt. And that will drain the excess cerebral spinal fluid off the brain. And they will actually have a pump on that. So you can actually feel it on the person's head. And if you feel around, you can actually feel like a little elevation. That's the pump, because sometimes debris can block that shunt. And if that's not removed, the pressure builds up and they can die. Just really quick story. About 10 years ago, I'm working at the company, and a guy, he gets a job as a sales guy. And, you know, I can't walk up to people and say, hey, there's something wrong with you. So he comes to me and he goes, Tim, I just want to let you know that I have a ventricular shunt. He had a congenitally narrow cerebral aqueduct, so the pressure would build up. Anyways, I said, okay, you know. And the guy had a really nice head of hair, and I felt bad for him. But anyways, I don't know, maybe 6, 7 years later, on a Friday, I'm talking to him. Then all of a sudden, his eyes roll in the back of his head, and he goes down. I catch him, and then I go, call 911. So the owner of the company, you know, and the other people are around, and I'm going like this, right? And then the owner goes, Tim, what are you doing? And I go, I'm pumping his shunt. So I found the pump. I pumped it a few times, and a few seconds later, he started coming out of it. Now, watch. Is a shunt a normal thing to have in your head? Good. You should write that down. So the immune system is going to look at that and say, what the hell is that? And it will put scar tissue over it. So if that shunt has been in there a while, they don't remove it. They just put another one in. And, you know, now if you get 16 shunts in there, right, they're going to start taking some of them out. They have to. But they typically don't remove it. They just put in a new one. And no one can predict how long these shunts will last. They can last for the lifetime, or they can go bad in 2 weeks. You just don't know. That could have very well happened, right? So, it's not like a garden hose, right, where it's real thick. It has to be thin because you want to take up as least room as possible when you're inserting that shunt. So, that's very possible, very possible. But that cranial pressure builds up very rapidly. Cerebral spinal fluid is turned over about 4 times a day. Right, so you have 4 times a day you have brand new cerebral spinal fluid circulating around your brain and spinal cord. Yeah? All right. This is what I want to explain to you. Watch. How many cervical vertebrae you got? Seven? How many thoracic?
12.
12. And how many lumbar?
5.
This is lumbar vertebrae number 1. Your true spinal cord. True spinal cord. The cord itself ends at about L1. Now, you have spinal nerves that come off, but the actual tube of the spinal cord ends at L1. Do you got me? So, when they want to get a sample of cerebral spinal fluid, do they do it up here or here? They typically do it between L3 and L4. And the reason they do that, and that's why I mentioned it, cerebral spinal fluid circulates around the entire length of the spinal cord. So the reason they do it between L3 and L4 is to reduce the potential damage to nerves. Tell me you got that. So if you start doing it up here and you do it wrong, you can damage the spinal cord so everything below it can be jacked up. So you do it in between here to reduce the likelihood that a person is going to have any neurological problems following that. Say yes, you got that. Okay. I want to show you one more thing. How many people have ever had an epidural? How did you feel about it? Did you like it?
No.
Why not?
They kept getting the nerve, so they had to stop after trial 3.
Well, you know what I'm doing is I'm going on vacation, and I'm going to have an epidural part of my vacation. Okay, watch. This is a cross-section of your spinal cord, right? So let me give you some, landmarks so you can kind of know where you're at, right? So you got your spinal cord, yeah? Then you have this layer that covers the spinal cord itself called the pia mater, right? Then you have the space here. What's that space called? The subarachnoid space. So where does cerebral spinal fluid circulate?
Right there.
There you go. Then,
let me get a little better here.
Then you have, suspended above the pia, you have the arachnoid mater. And then you have this thick, tough layer called the dura mater. All right, what does epi mean? Above or outside, right? So when they do an epidural, they don't inject the medicine into the cerebral spinal fluid. They inject it into the epidural space. But some teachers better than others, some nurses better, anesthesiologists better than others. So when they stick the spinal nerve or the spinal needle in, you're going to feel a give because there's some tough connective tissue here, right? Then you're in the epidural space, which is basically fat and some blood vessels. So when you have the epidural space right here, they inject the medication, and anything below that point of injection will be anesthetized. Say yes. Now, if a doctor who's doing the epidural goes in and you feel a give, and then you push in a little farther and you feel another give, then you can put that epidural needle into the cerebral spinal fluid because you put a hole in the dura and the arachnoid mater. And after your procedure, when you sit up, all of that cerebral spinal fluid, watch, the pressure of that cerebral spinal fluid is greatest at the lower part of your spinal cord, and it will start coming out of that hole. And that cerebral spinal fluid is designed to put buoyancy to the brain. So your brain will start resting on the base of your skull and you get a nasty headache. So they will tell you to lay as flat as possible, right? Give it a couple hours to see if it will close off by itself. And if it doesn't, they do what's called a blood patch. You've heard of this? Never heard of it? You've heard of it? Did I show you?
Yeah.
So I showed you the video, right, about that?
No, you were doing the lab.
Oh. So now I'm going to show you the blood patch video. Aren't you excited about the blood patch video?
Yeah.
Elizabeth, are you excited to watch the blood patch video? I can tell. You were literally on the edge of your seat. I know what you're thinking right now. You know what she's thinking? Come on, stop talking and get to that blood patch video. I really want to see it. I'm doing the best I can, okay? I'm just a man at a technical college. I'm not getting up to change that, so you're going to have to come all over here and look.
What?
I'm just kidding. What does blood do that is taken out of your cardiovascular system? If you cut yourself and there's some blood on the table, what will that blood do? It will clot, right? So what they do in this procedure is they draw the patient's own blood, roughly 20 cc's, right? Then they reinsert the spinal needle, and then they will inject their own blood into the epidural space. And they will inject it slowly, and as they're injecting it, they're asking the patient, do you still have a headache? Do you still have a headache? Do you still have a headache? Because as soon as that cerebral spinal fluid, that hole is patched up, the pressure
cerebral spinal fluid should go back up, and the brain will get buoyed up, so the headache should go away. Tell me you got that. So watch. So they have to keep that needle in for a couple of weeks, and they can't take it out. So you just want to go up to them and go boing, and then they're asking the person, "You got a headache? Got a headache? Got a headache?" And once the headache goes away, then they leave them be, and the blood will clot and ultimately form little scar tissue, and they're straight. So you just want to go boing, boing. Yes, that's why you have to practice. You have to be skilled. And some people are better than others. Yes, if it's done really poorly, yes. That's why you want to limit the potential damage to the spinal cord proper. That's why they do it between L3 and L4. No, I mean, and look, it's like anything else. You know, the more people do something, the better they get at it. That's why if you're going to have a particular procedure, you go to a hospital where they do these things routinely. Because the more you do, the better you get at it. See, yeah, that's a blood patch. All right, hang on. The caliper or the gauge? I don't know. That thing is it's giant, right? So I wouldn't want that. Did I show you this video? This is a spinal tap. Now they want to get a sample of cerebral spinal fluid, right? So they have to actually go through the dura and the arachnoid mater to get into the subarachnoid space to get the cerebral spinal fluid out. Two things I'm going to point out in this video. Plumber's crack, big time, right? And then watch the nurse later in the video. She'll be checking her cell phone. I found out where this video was made in the hospital, and I called, and I got that nurse fired. Yeah. Now, Dr. Galakowicz here, he makes a mistake, too. Watch. Picks up the sterile gloves off the floor. Didn't you learn, like in CNA, anything below your waist is considered dirty? Now, he's using a little betadine here. Not shown in the video. I think they cut that out. He took a little swig off that. Mm-hmm. So, a little dab will do you. They start in the middle, and then they work out to move bacteria and cells out of the way. So that's why the little bullseye. And then he's going to go between, typically between L3 and L4. And that needle's big, and you kind of got to have to go like at about a 45-degree angle because you got to get between that spinous process, and you want to get in there.
That's why he's like curled?
That's why he's curled, because you're curled to open up the space. So, all right, so yeah. If you could curl them like this, they would be really easy. It would get hurt, but... So, again, you're going right into the subarachnoid space. We'll cut to the chase here. Okay, so he's pushing it in. Now, and then what he'll do is he'll advance the needle until he gets a return of cerebral spinal fluid. And then after he gets cerebral spinal fluid, He's going to put a manometer on there. He's going to measure the pressure that the cerebral spinal fluid is creating around the brain and spinal cord. And in adults, it's usually about 20 to 30 centimeters of water. Now, I'm going to hold it there for a minute. Now, watch. The reason they have the person lay on their side and they try to get them as level as possible, so when they do the lumbar puncture here, that will give you a relative indication of the pressure that the cerebral spinal fluid is exerting on the brain. So that's why they do that. If they sit them up, then the pressure here is going to be much higher than the brain. That's why they lay them flat. Okay, did you see the where the nurse checked her cell phone? Wait, it's coming up. Do you notice how she had time to get her nails done, too? Did you notice that? Clearly, she didn't have time to read the textbook, huh? What? See? Did you see that? Who saw it? I would have fired her. I said, get out. Got time for that. Yeah. And this guy, he was sagging, too, when he came in. What? Yeah. If anyone gets a voluntary epidural, I'll give you 50 points of extra credit. No? Okay. All right, go ahead, take a break. All right, so here we go. Just like in all cells, you have a cell membrane. So this big part, this starry looking part, this is referred to as the nerve cell body or the cell body of the neuron. And cell bodies of the neuron, inside them, they contain a nucleus which contains DNA. Please get this right. What does DNA code for? What's that? And what do amino acids chemically combined make? Nice, that's very good. See, you redeemed yourself. So DNA, this DNA codes for protein. And we just learned that neurotransmitters are mostly proteins. Didn't we learn that? Didn't we? So watch. When the cell body produces a neurotransmitter, it wraps it up in a little piece of the Golgi apparatus, and it transports it through the cytoplasm of this extension called an axon. And it will travel down, maybe stop at Burger King or Walmart and pick up some toilet paper, then make its way down to the end of the axon. The end of the axon, this little ball here, this little knob, is called the axon knob. What's stored in the axon knob? What? I just told you. You guys don't pay attention to nothing. Neurotransmitter. Tell me you're with me. You got that. Now, watch. This is the axon. Axons transmit neural info in the form of electrical impulses. What creates that those electrical impulse? Not going to believe it. Electrolytes. You got me? And when this electrical impulse is created by this neuron, it travels from bare spot to bare spot on that axon. Those bare spots on the axon are called nodes of Ranvier. So this is where the electrical impulse is actually produced, in these bare spots. The little fatty insulation, no electrical impulses are put there. That's why, which is quicker, right? I want to get from here to there. So I go like this, or I go like this. So what it appears to do with the myelination and then those bare spots, the nodes of Ranvier, it appears that the impulse hops from one node to the other. And that speeds the conduction by hundreds of times. And that's what allows us to be, you know, top of the food chain. Are you writing that down? All right. Now watch. Watch. What's stored at the end of the axon in the axon knob? A neurotransmitter. How this neuron releases a neurotransmitter is by producing an electrical impulse. That electrical impulse will then trigger the release of the neurotransmitter. Are you following this? Guys, who's following this? Laura? Are you following this?
Yes.
That's good. Watch. These little extensions, these little feelers off the cell body, dendrites. Dendrites collect neural info. Now, and dendrites and axons communicate with one another. You paying attention to this? Watch. That was just dripping with sarcasm. That was good though, I like that. Anybody? Haley Hicks forgets this class is subjective. Give myself a high five for that one. Okay, enough of Haley Hicks and her sarcasm, which I appreciate, actually. I really do. That's good. I'm going to have to label this quickly. Stored at the end of the axon knob is the neurotransmitter, right? Dendrite, you're not going to believe this. What did I tell you? In order for this nerve to affect this nerve, it has to release a neurotransmitter. But in order for this neurotransmitter to affect this nerve, it has to bind with a specific neurotransmitter receptor. You got me? So watch. This nerve is stimulated. Where do you actually produce the beginning of the electrical impulse in that neuron? It's called the axon hillock. The axon hillock is what causes, initiates the electrical impulse. When this little axon hillock fires, it's going to tell this node to fire, and then this node, and then they tell two friends, and so on, all the way down to the axon knob. So this little wavy line illustrated in blue indicates the electrical impulse traveling over the axon knob. When that axon knob is electrically stimulated, it will cause the release of the neurotransmitter through the process of exocytosis. Oh, I'm bringing it home today. And when that neurotransmitter binds to that specific neurotransmitter receptor, it will do one of two things. It will either tell that neuron to fire or tell it not to fire. So our brains work exactly like a computer, ones and zeros. The neuron either fires or it doesn't. It's that simple. say yes.
This is very important. As long as that neurotransmitter is bound to that receptor, that neuron will fire. Do you always want to be firing that neuron?
No.
No, you don't. So floating out in the cytoplasm is a little Pac-Man. That Pac-Man. That ain't bad. Is an enzyme called monoamine oxidase. How many people have had psychology? You learned about monoamine oxidase, didn't you? No, you don't remember. You ain't even remember this. Bunch of haters. Haters. Haters are my motivators. Okay, ready? Watch. Monoamine oxidase is an enzyme that will degrade that neurotransmitter. Once that neurotransmitter is degraded, if it was produced an electrical impulse, the electrical impulse stopped. Say yes. You got that. The other way that neurotransmitters are removed is they are reuptaked. They are brought back in to the presynaptic or the axon knob and degraded. Tell me you got that. Now, just real quick, and I ain't getting it all metaphysical on you. Ready? When people say they have a chemical imbalance in the brain, what they're really, I think what they're referring to is they either have too much or not enough neurotransmitter. So the neurotransmitters that are associated with mood are serotonin and norepinephrine. So if you are depressed, you're not releasing enough serotonin and norepinephrine. So do you want what you are releasing to be degraded by that monoamine oxidase? No. So back in the 60s, they came up with monoamine oxidase inhibitors. One of it's called Nardil. The problem with that drug is that it was very powerful and had nasty side effects.
MOAIs, right?
Yeah.
But they've changed those to SSRIs now.
Oh, look at her. Look at her. You are really bringing it today. I mean, you're adding anecdotal information. This is incredible. What's the transformation? I'm not even playing.
Well, I had almost like last night.
You remember that stuff, but you don't know where the gallbladder is now, do you? Watch. They came up with monoamine oxidase inhibitors, but there was a lot of bad side effects with these things. So back in the 70s, late 70s, early 80s, they came up with medication that would prevent the reuptakedness back into the presynaptic membrane. Those were the SSRIs, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or the selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors. So watch. Again, just real quick. Write this down. Life has its ups and downs. You know what I figured out about people? They don't want to feel anything. They don't. I had this one lady, right? I did a research study on depression. Do you know what the FS36 is? Yeah, okay. Well, good. I'm going to tell you something you don't know. So there. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. It's a psychometric tool that looks at anxiety, depression, and somatoform. What's somatoform?
Isn't it like where you're always sleeping or something like that?
That's catatonic. Okay. Somatoform is, I think I have a bad back, but I really don't. It's all in my head. So your brain can actually make you sick. There's truth to that, no question. So anyways, this lady comes in, and I spoke with the front staff. I said, anyone who comes in and says, I need to talk to a doctor, I'm depressed, call Timmy. I'll make him more depressed. Anyways, we had a little box questionnaire, 36 questions, right? So I said, please answer these questions and then bring it back, right? So I print out her results, and then I bring her into an exam room, and I said, why are you depressed? And she goes, my mom died. I go, when did your mom die? She died a week ago.
After probably 3 or 2 years, if you're still sad, then you have
doesn't. Oh, she doesn't say anything. Oh, wait, she doesn't talk all semester. Now, you, that's a you, can't shut her up. Now watch. So I couldn't help myself because I'm kind of reactionary. Have you noticed? After she told me that she was depressed and their ma died a week ago, I looked at her and I go, oh, you're supposed to be depressed. That's sad. Your ma died a week ago. A year from now, you're still depressed about it? Then come and talk to me. And she got upset with me. But what I found out is that people don't want to feel bad, sad, or happy. They want to go through life how my advanced students go through my class. That's just, now watch. People, I say, well, I don't want to take a pill to feel better. Why not? Watch. Your goal in life and my goal in life is the same goal, to be happy and content, right? So if you can take a medication that helps you achieve that, what's wrong with that? What is wrong with that? You wouldn't believe the people who are on these medications. I had this one lady, for lack of a better term, she was a straight up bitch. She was. She worked at this company for like 10 years. Every time I'd walk by, she'd leave. Give me these nasty looks, right? And then, all of a sudden, probably in about a 6-month period, I would see her. Hi, Tim, how you doing? Hi, Ann, how are you? And I'd walk away, I'm like, so, you know me, I gotta ask. So I said, Ann, what's going on? That's exactly what I said to her. And she goes, what do you mean? I said, look, and I'm not gonna be rude, I'm just gonna tell you as I saw it. You were a bitch. Like, you were just, it was really weird. I could never talk to you. Tim, I started on Prozac, and what, it changed my life. I go, it certainly did. I'm not even kidding. And then she would try to go off of it. And I would make the comment to her, you're trying to go off of it, aren't you? She goes, how do you know? I go, you're a bitch again. But what an engaging lady. Fun to talk to. Really wonderful sense of humor, right? I mean, it was incredible the transformation that occurred in this person. And she goes, I realize I can't live without that stuff. But it was weird because, like, people, well, I don't want to do this. I got this guy, same thing. The guy is, he's worried about this guy's fault. This guy has got more money in the bank than I could ever dream of, right? He goes, well, you know, it's really expensive. I go, oh, God. So I gave him the name of my doctor, who was my personal physician when I lived in Chicago. I go, talk to this guy. He's a good dude. So he goes and sees me. He goes, Tim told me to talk to you about this. You know, what do you think? And he goes, it's really up to you. So he just started on Paxil, right? What a transformation. His name's Milan. Milan, how you doing? Good, Tim. I go, sky falling today? No, it's nice out. I'm gonna ref some soccer games up in McHenry. I go, rock on. What does he do? 3 months goes off of it, right? I go, you're off of it, aren't you? Well, it was expensive. I don't get it. Everybody wants a shot at happiness and contentment. And I'm not talking about, and this is what people don't get. Watch. Thoughts are things. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he, right? Here's my point. I ain't going to get crazy on you. But there are circumstances and situations in your life that can actually alter your brain chemistry. That's a fact. So if you can take a medication that starts helping you think right, where at some point you may not do it because you've started thinking right and developing coping skills for that, why not? Why not? And that, you know, even now it's still, well, I don't want people to know I'm on this. You wouldn't believe that people were on this stuff. I couldn't believe it. When people were telling me, I'm like, damn, maybe I should try it. You know what I mean? So I say it unto you. Why not? All right. So that's how, like, Prozac, Paxil, Effexor, that's how those work. Now, real quick, just real quick, we got to get going. Watch. Have you ever heard of bipolar?
Yeah,
what's that?
Which one?
What do you mean, which one? You want to fight about this now? Okay, watch. Just bipolar. Okay, watch. What they believe is that these people who are bipolar have an inability to regulate the amount of neurotransmitter that's released at any given time. So when they're in their manic phase, they're releasing tons of neurotransmitter, right? So the neurons are all excited. And then you get what's called fatigue at the synapse. You've released all this neurotransmitter. You got no neurotransmitter left to release. So that's when you go into your depression phase. And to some degree, the level of your manic phase determines the level of your depressed phase. So if you are just out there, right, not sleeping, right, traveling, just doing all kinds of crazy stuff, then your depressed phase is almost catatonic, where you don't come out of the bed, the room is dark for 5 days, 10 days. So there's a drug out there called lithium. And what lithium does is it stabilizes the axon knob and only allows a certain amount of neurotransmitter to be released. Again, these drugs are very, very toxic. Lithium, the toxic dose and the therapeutic dose are very, very close, so they have to be monitored frequently. So, and that brings us into ADHD. What they believe is that these people are releasing, again, a ton of neurotransmitter. So what Ritalin does is it actually increases the amount of neurotransmitter that's released, so you produce fatigue at the synapse. So the kid was like all over the place, oh, there's a squirrel. Oh, that's left clavicord. And then you take Ritalin, and because you basically exhausted your neurotransmitter supply, then they're like, kind of like that. That's why Ritalin can be used to treat ADHD in adolescents and depression in adults. Because in depression, you don't release enough. So if you release more, you won't be as depressed. Absolutely. So one of the reasons they believe Adderall works, and basically Adderall is it's an amphetamine. It's like cocaine. How it works is that it will stimulate brain activity so that people don't have to seek outside stimuli in order to function. They're getting their brain stimulated within, so that allows them to focus on stuff. When I was in college, my buddy turned me on to that stuff. I'm taking physical chemistry. It's the physics of chemistry. You think this stuff is hard? There was 110 people in the lecture hall at the start. 9 people took that final, right? 6 of us passed. Timmy passed, right? And I got a bumper sticker that said, I passed P-Chem. It was pass-fail. You didn't get a grade, pass-fail. Anyways, he gives me this stuff, and I take it, and I am sitting in my little apartment in my room, and I'm reading this textbook, and I started at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and I looked up, and it was 1 o'clock in the morning. I didn't go pee. I didn't get up. I'm like, what the hell just happened? Right? And then couldn't sleep all night, so I am climbing the walls because it's basically speed. Adderall. Yeah. So I stay away from that. But like, you know, and I know students what they'll do. For like finals, they'll take it. But here's the thing. It doesn't improve your long-term memory. It improves your short-term memory, but that ain't going to help you long-term. And don't mess with that. You don't need it. Just so you know, before you take the final, you're dropping. All of you. I'm going to check your urine. See if you're employed. Get any Adderall in there. Mark your life wrong. Tell me you got that. Now watch. Watch. This area where an axon and a dendrite communicate, that's a synapse. Right? The axon now, presynaptic membrane, dendrite or cell body, postsynaptic membrane. And in order for it to exert its effect, it has to bind to a specific neurotransmitter. Say yes. Got that. All right, watch. Cell body, cytoplasm, DNA, makes the neurotransmitters, has all the metabolic machinery of any other cell. Extensions of the cell body, dendrites, axon hillock, when that nerve is stimulated to produce an electrical impulse, that's where it is initiated. The nodes of RAMVA produce the electrical impulse and it travels down the little bunny trail. The myelin sheath insulates the axon to produce what's called saltatory conduction or the impulse appearing to hop down the bunny trail. The axon knob stores the neurotransmitter based on the type of nerve that it is. Say yes. One more thing. The myelin sheath in the central nervous system is produced by oligodendrocytes. In the peripheral nervous system, Lara, what produces the myelin sheath? Huh? No, see, you're not even paying attention. You pay attention in your...
Schwann cells.
Too late. I already read it out. Schwann cells produce the myelin sheath in the peripheral nervous system. They also deliver meat, and like their chicken breasts are very good, too. Say yes. Okay, can I show you just one more thing, and then you can ambulate home, I think. Huh?
Sure.
Did I cover all the stuff in the nervous system? Just so you know, watch. Watch, and I'm not going to cover that. There is a video on the parts of the brain on YouTube. I do a very good job on that. I'm going to be like Joey Bag of Donuts. Oh, I did a great job on that video. How many people got that? Okay, let me show you this real quick. Oh, here's the 12 cranial nerves, too. You can go online. You can find a, like a little song, right, for the 12 cranial nerves. You better know that. Hang on. What was I going to show you? Oh, in the central nervous system and spinal cord, motor nerves are myelinated. In some people, the immune system didn't get the message that that myelin sheath is good for you. So their immune system will attack it and destroy that myelin sheath and replace it with essentially scar tissue, which is rich in calcium. The medical term for hard is sclerosis. And because it occurs in multiple areas of the motor area and spinal cord, it's called... So it's a destruction or a demyelination of the axons of motor nerves. And there's varying degrees of MS. Some can progress rapidly. Some, you may not have any symptoms until much, much later in life. It really depends. So because this is an autoimmune disease, meaning your own immune system is attacking it, then they will put their... they put them on drugs that suppress the immune system. So a lot of these people are on steroids or even more powerful drugs that suppress the immune system. The gold standard for diagnosing MS, number one, MRI. And these calcified lesions on the brain and spinal cord, they light right up. The other one is to do a spinal tap and to test for it's some type of antibody that's only found in people with MS, and it's found in the cerebral spinal fluid. Say, you got that? Yes or no? All right, can I show you just one more thing, and then, we're all going to fight.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't care. You know, right on the third floor, they have that little out, like little patio area. That'd be a good boxing ring. It's square. Okay, watch. The lateral aspects of the spinal cord are where a lot of motor nerves are. It's myelinated. In some people, you can get destruction of the motor nerves and the lateral aspects of the spinal cord. Now, if you've ever had a cast on your arm or leg for any length of time, when you take it off, the muscle has actually atrophied as a result. So in order for a muscle to maintain its tone or increase in size, you have to stimulate that muscle. So if the nerves are being destroyed by your immune system, the muscle will begin to atrophy. It won't grow. So you can develop a condition called amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS. Again, these are no cure autoimmune, but I want you to think about one thing while you're on your Thanksgiving break, okay? What are the odds of someone developing a disease that was named after them, like Lou Gehrig actually getting Lou Gehrig's disease? I had a student a couple years back. She goes, "Tim, I don't think that they named it after him and then he got it. I think he got it, and then they named it after him." I'm like, "You're kidding me." Okay, ambulate home. Okay, have a nice holiday, too. Oh, listen up. I shouldn't do this because that means more work for Timmy. Listen up. You can stay 2 seconds. I'm here to help you. If you don't want to be helped, you can ambulate home. Go.
We're staying. We're the only ones who show up.
We need to fight. All right. The nervous system take-home quiz. If you want to do that for extra credit, not extra credit, but to improve your grade, you can turn that in on Monday.
Along with the urinary?
I thought you turned in the urinary.
No, that's next Monday.
Oh, okay, then you know what? Do this. Turn in the urinary on Monday, and then the following Monday, turn in the nervous system. So, wait, so I get dates right. All right. So that would be December 5th. You will turn in the nervous system take-home. Watch. If you don't score better on it than your average weighted total, I'm not counting it. Because if you do worse and I count it, it drops your grade. Tell me you got that. You don't have to do it if you don't want to. As a matter of fact, you don't have to do anything if you don't want to except die and pay.